ओ लेवल फिजिक्स पेपर कोड 5054 पेपर वन वेरिएंट वन अक्टूबर नवंबर 2011 क्वेश्चन नंबर वन द डायमीटर एंड लेंथ ऑफ अ थिन वायर अप्रोक्सीमेटली 1 मीटर इन लेंथ आर मेजर्ड एज एक्यूरेटली एज पॉसिबल व्हाट आर द बेस्ट इंस्ट्रूमेंट टू यूज हियर वी हैव टू मेजर डायमीटर एंड वी हैव टू मेजर लेंथ एंड लेंथ ऑफ दिस वायर इज अप्रोक्सीमेटली 1 मीटर अप टू 1 मीटर To find out length, we use a instrument that is called meter rule or simply rule. Since here length is approximately 1 meter, so to measure length, we have to use a meter rule or a rule that is given in option A and D. Now to find our diameter, either we can use a micrometer or we can use a vernier caliper. But from micrometer, we can measure the diameter more accurately. Because least count of micrometer is less than vernier caliper, so micrometer will give us more precise value as compared to vernier caliper. Since here we have to measure the diameter as accurately as possible, so here our best option will be micrometer to calculate diameter of this thin wire. Now micrometer is given in option A. So our correct option will be option A. To measure diameter, we have to use micrometer, and to measure length, we have to use a rule. Question number 2, a quantity is quoted as having a value of 6.2 ms. This ms is symbol for millisecond. So here it is time, it is 6.2 millisecond. In what units it is measured? Option A, meters. B meter per second, C microsecond, D millisecond. So here our correct option will be definitely option D, where it is given millisecond. Question number 3. The graph shows part of a journey made by a cyclist. How far did the cyclist travel in 7 seconds? To find out the distance traveled, we have to find out the total area under this curve. Now this curve is divided in 2 parts. We have drawn a line. After drawing a line, this part is a rectangle and this part is a trapezium. So here we have to find out area of this rectangle and area of this trapezium, and we will add these 2 area to find out the total area under the curve. That will be the distance covered by the cyclist. Now area under this curve, this rectangle, will be equal to 0 to 5, it is 5 units, 0 to 4, it is 4 units, so length is 5 units, breadth is 4 units, and area of a rectangle is given as length into breadth, so area of this rectangle will be 5 multiplied by 4, it will be 20. Now area of this trapezium, to find out area of trapezium, we have formula half sum of parallel side multiplied by height. So here the value of this trapezium will be equal to half. Starting from this point to this point, it is 4 units. Starting from this point to this point, it is 6 units. So it will become 4 plus 6, it will be 10. And what about the height? Height is the distance from this point to this point, it will be 2 units. So here, area of trapezium will be equal to half, 4 plus 6 multiplied by 2. It will be equal to 6 plus 4, 10, 10 multiplied by 2, 20, 20 divided by 2, it will be 10. So 20 plus 10, it will be 30 meters, and 30 meter is given in option B, so correct option will be option B. Question number 4, the propeller on a boat pushes water backward with a force of 2000 Newton. The boat moves through the water against a total resistive force of 1800 Newton. According to Newton's third law, what is the force exerted on the propeller due to the water? What is Newton's third law? Newton's third law states action and reaction are equal but in opposite direction. Now here action by the propeller on water is 2000 Newton. So the reaction will also be equal to 2000 Newton but in opposite direction. If the force exerted by the propeller is on right hand side, then the force exerted by the water on the propeller will be on left hand side, but of same magnitude, that is given here 2000 Newton. So here, according to Newton's third law of motion, forward force on the propeller due to the water will be 2000 Newton, that is given in option C. सो करेक्ट ऑप्शन विल बी ऑप्शन सी। क्वेश्चन नंबर फाइव, द डायग्राम शोज अ पैराशूटिस्ट इन फोर पोजीशन आफ्टर शी जंप्स फ्रॉम अ हाई बलून, एट विच पोजीशन डज शी हैव टर्मिनल वेलोसिटी। टर्मिनल वेलोसिटी मीन्स कॉन्स्टेंट वेलोसिटी, द ऑब्जेक्ट इज मूविंग विद अ कॉन्स्टेंट वेलोसिटी मीन्स देयर इज नो एक्सिलरेशन। नाउ वी चेक द ऑप्शंस, ऑप्शन ए नॉट येट मूविंग, फॉर टर्मिनल वेलोसिटी द ऑब्जेक्ट शुड बी मूविंग विद कॉन्स्टेंट स्पीड, हेयर द ऑब्जेक्ट इज नॉट मूविंग सो ए इज नॉट द पॉसिबल ऑप्शन। ऑप्शन बी एक्सिलरेटिंग, since here it is given accelerating and for terminal velocity there should be no acceleration, it should move with a constant speed, so option B is also not the possible option. In option C it is given not accelerating, yes it may be our correct option. If it is not accelerating then it will be moving with a constant speed, and terminal velocity means the object is moving with a constant speed, so our possible option is option C. What is given in option D? Not moving. Since the object is not moving, so here the speed or velocity will be zero. And for terminal velocity, it should be moving with a constant speed. So option D is also not the possible option. The only possible option is option C, not accelerating. Question number 6. An engine pulls a truck at constant speed on a level track. The link between the truck and the engine brakes, the driving force on the engine remains constant. What effect does this have on the truck and on the engine? Here we have two columns. First column is for truck and second column is for engine. Now here, if this link is broken, what will happen? Here, if this link is broken and the amount of force is same as before, then whatever be the force that was exerting before on engine and the truck is now exerting only on the engine, so this engine will speed up and this truck will be slowed down, because on the truck there is no more force, so it will be slowed down and this engine will be speeds up. Now we check the options. In option A it is given truck slows down, and for the engine it is given speed stays constant. Speed will not stay constant, it will be speed up, so A is not the possible option. In B it is given truck slows down and engine speeds up, yes it is our correct option. When this link will be broken, this truck will be slows down and this engine will be speeds up, so correct option will be option B. Question number 7. The weight of a stone is found using a Newton meter and its mass is found using a pan balance. The experiment is carried out on the earth and on the moon. For each meter in its reading, the same or different on the earth and on the moon. With the help of Newton meter, we measure weight. With the help of pan balance, we find out mass of the object. Mass of the object always remains constant, but weight depends on gravitational pull. Since gravitational pull on earth and moon is different, so weight will be different, but mass will remain same, because mass is defined as quantity of matter. Quantity of matter will not change whether the object is on earth or it is at moon. So the reading that is taken by the pan balance is mass, it will remain same, it will not change, and the reading that is taken by Newton meter is weight. This weight will be changed, weight will be different on earth and moon. Now reading on Newton meter will be different. Different is given in A and B, so possible option will be A and B. Reading on the pan balance is given in A, it is different, in B it is given same. Since it is discussed that the reading on the pan balance is the measurement of mass and mass does not change, it remains same, so our correct option will be option B. Reading on Newton meter different, reading on pan balance same. So correct option will be option B. Question number 8. The extension of a spring is measured as weight are added. The graph shows the result. Which point is the spring's limit of proportionality? Here we have a graph. This graph is plotted in between weight and extension. And this topic is related to Hooke's law. In Hooke's law, we have studied that weight and extension are directly proportional to each other up to a certain extent. And after that point, after that extent, with the increase in weight, extension is no more directly proportional to weight added. Now, the maximum point up to which weight and extension are directly proportional to each other is called limit of proportionality. So here, limit of proportionality will be point B, because up to point B, it is shown in a straight line. And when we plot a graph in between two physical quantities that are directly proportional to each other, it is in a straight line. Since weight and extension up to point B are directly proportional to each other, so up to point B, it is a straight line. And after point B, weight and extension are no more directly proportional to each other. So after B, it is not in a straight line. And this point B is called limit of proportionality. So correct option will be option B. Question number 9. A metal cone with a circular base is placed on a flat surface. The stability of the cone depends on. Stability depends on two factors. First thing, on base area, and second thing, the position of center of mass of the object. Lesser the height of center of mass, greater will be the stability. More base area, greater will be the stability. Now we check the options. Option A, its weight only. No, it does not depend on weight. It depends on center of mass, position of center of mass, and also on base area. So A is incorrect. Option B, the diameter of its base and the position of its center of mass. Yes, definitely it is our correct option, correct answer. It depends on base area, or we can say it depends on diameter of its base, and also it depends on the position of center of mass. Lesser the height, more will be the stability. So correct option will be option B. Question number 10. The efficiency of an electrical generator is 65%. The energy input to the generator is 12 kilojoule. What is the useful energy output? Efficiency is given as output over input. Now efficiency is given 65%. Output we have to calculate, we have to find out. Input is given 12 kilojoule. Now efficiency is 65%. 65% means 65 divided by 100, it will be 0.65. So here this relation will become 0.65 is equal to output over 12, and output will be equal to 0.65 multiplied by 12, it will be 7.8 kilojoules. Now 7.8 kilojoule is given in option C. So correct option will be option C. So what will be the correct option? Correct option is option C. Question number 11. Coal is burned as fuel to heat water in a boiler, producing steam. The steam drives a turbine which is connected to an electric generator. In which order do the major energy transformation take place? When coal is burned, chemical energy is converted to heat energy. Now because of this heat energy, water boils and it is converted to steam. Now this steam falls on the blades of a turbine, and the turbine drives, or the turbine rotates. So here what is the order? Chemical energy is converted to heat energy. Heat energy is converted to kinetic energy. Now this turbine is connected to an electric generator where electrical energy is produced. So what is the sequence? What is the order? Chemical is converted to heat energy. Heat energy is converted to kinetic energy, and kinetic energy is converted to electrical energy. Now same order is given in option B. Chemical energy is converted to heat energy. Heat energy is converted to kinetic energy. Kinetic energy is converted to electrical energy. So correct option, option B. Question number 2. A crane moves its load diagonally as shown. By which distance is the weight of the load multiplied to calculate the change in gravitational potential energy of the load? Gravitational potential energy is given as mgh, where m for mass, g for acceleration due to gravity, and h is height, or the vertical distance moved by the object. Now here the vertical distance moved by the object is shown by alphabet B. It is the vertical distance or height that is moved by this object. So to find out the change in gravitational potential energy, we have to multiply mg with this vertical distance with the distance that is given in option B. So correct option will be option B. Question number 13. The diagram shows two identical pieces of apparatus. One is filled with water and the other is filled with mercury. Water is less dense than mercury. At which point is the liquid pressure greatest? Pressure exerted by a liquid is given as P is equal to rho gh, where rho for density, g for acceleration due to gravity, and h is the height. Height means the vertical distance from the surface of the liquid to the point where we have to find out the pressure. Means here, if we have to find out the pressure at point A, then this value h will be the vertical distance from this surface of the liquid to this point A. Now here it is given water is less dense than mercury. Means density of water is less, density of mercury is more. And pressure depends on density. With the increase in density, pressure will be increased. Since density of mercury is more as compared to water, so definitely the pressure exerted by mercury will be more as compared to pressure exerted by water. So our possible option will be C and D. Now second thing, pressure also depends on the vertical distance from the surface of the liquid. Now if we check the distance from this surface of the liquid to point C, this distance is less as compared to distance from the surface of the liquid to point D. So here the greatest pressure will be at point D because here the vertical distance or h is more as compared to vertical distance or the height from the surface of the liquid to point C. So here our correct option will be option D. At point D the pressure will be greatest because of the fact the density of mercury is more as compared to density of water. And second thing, the height in column D is more as compared to height in column C. So here our correct option will be option D. Question number 14. Object with different weights are placed on a rigid horizontal surface. Which row shows the correct pressure acting on the surface? Pressure exerted by a solid is given as P is equal to F over A, where F for force and A is for area in contact. Now here we have three columns. In the first column weight is given, in the second column area, and in third column pressure in Newton meter is given. In option A, weight or force is 10 Newton, area in contact is 0.1. So here pressure exerted will be equal to 10 divided by 0.1. It will be equal to 100 Newton per meter square. But here it is given 1. So this option is incorrect. In B, force or weight is given 20, area is given 0.2. Again, here when we will divide 20 by 0.2, we will get 100 Newton per meter square. And here it is 0.01, so this option is also incorrect. In C, weight or force is 30 Newton, area in contact is 0.1. When we will divide 30 by 0.1, we will get 300 Newton per meter square. So our correct option will be option C. What is given in option D? Weight or force is given 40 Newton, area in contact is 0.2. When we will divide 40 by 0.2, we will get 200, and here it is given 8. So this one is also incorrect. So correct option is option C. When we will divide 30 by 0.1, we will get 300 Newton per meter square. So correct option will be option C. Question number 15. How does heat transfer through a vacuum take place? Option A, by conduction, convection and radiation. Option B, by conduction only. Option C, by convection only. Option D, by radiation only. Conduction and convection is a heat transfer method that requires a material medium. And radiation is a heat transfer method where a material medium is not required. Here it is given through a vacuum. So through a vacuum means without any material medium, heat can be transferred only because of radiation. That is given in option D, by radiation only. तो करेक्ट ऑप्शन विल बी ऑप्शन डी। क्वेश्चन नंबर 16, विच रो एक्सप्लेन्स व्हाई अ लिक्विड हैज अ फिक्स वॉल्यूम बट डज नॉट हैव अ फिक्स शेप। हियर वी हैव टू कॉलम। इन द फर्स्ट कॉलम फोर्स बिटवीन द मॉलिक्यूल्स इन अ लिक्विड इज गिवन। इन द सेकेंड कॉलम मूवमेंट ऑफ द मॉलिक्यूल्स इन अ लिक्विड इज गिवन। फॉर फोर्स बिटवीन द मॉलिक्यूल्स इन ऑप्शन ए एंड बी इट इज गिवन लार्ज एंड फॉर सी एंड डी इट इज गिवन स्मॉल। इंटरमॉलिक्यूलर फोर्स ऑफ अट्रैक्शन इन लिक्विड इज लार्ज। इंटरमॉलिक्यूलर फोर्स ऑफ अट्रैक्शन इज स्मॉल ओनली इन गैसेस। सो अवर पॉसिबल ऑप्शन विल बी ए एंड बी बिकॉज सी एंड डी आर नॉट द पॉसिबल ऑप्शन। दिस प्रॉपर्टी इज फॉर गैसेस। नाउ वी हैव टू चेक ओनली ऑप्शन ए एंड बी। नाउ सेकेंड कॉलम मूवमेंट ऑफ मॉलिक्यूल इन अ लिक्विड। फॉर ऑप्शन ए इट इज गिवन मूव थ्रू आउट द लिक्विड। यस इट इज करेक्ट। इन बी इट इज गिवन वाइब्रेट एट फिक्स पोजिशन। वाइब्रेट एट फिक्स पोजिशन इज प्रॉपर्टी ऑफ सॉलिड नॉट ऑफ लिक्विड। सो बी इज इनकरेक्ट। करेक्ट ऑप्शन इज ऑप्शन ए। इन अ लिक्विड इंटरमोलिकुलर फोर्स ऑफ अट्रैक्शन इज लार्ज एंड द मॉलिक्यूल्स मूव थ्रू आउट द लिक्विड। दे डू नॉट रिमेन एट देयर फिक्स पोजिशन। सो करेक्ट ऑप्शन विल बी ऑप्शन ए। क्वेश्चन नंबर 17, टू रेज द टेम्परेचर ऑफ अ 2 किलोग्राम ब्लॉक ऑफ मेटल बाय 20 डिग्री सेंटीग्रेड एनर्जी ऑफ 5.2 किलो जूल इज नीडेड। व्हाट इज द वैल्यू ऑफ द स्पेसिफिक हीट कैपेसिटी ऑफ द मेटल। टू फाइंड आउट स्पेसिफिक हीट कैपेसिटी ऑफ द मेटल वी विल यूज द फॉर्मूला क्यू इज इक्वल टू एम सी डेल्टा टी। वेयर क्यू अमाउंट ऑफ हीट, एम फॉर मैस, सी फॉर स्पेसिफिक हीट एंड डेल्टा टी फॉर चेंज इन टेम्परेचर। Here amount of heat is given 5.2 kilo joule, but here we have to consider amount of heat in joules. So here this 5.2 we have to multiply by 1000 to convert this 5.2 kilo joules to joules. So in joules amount of heat will be equal to 5.2 into 1000. Now mass is given 2 kilogram. This C specific heat we have to find out. This delta T change in temperature, and here it is given that to raise the temperature of 2 kilogram block of metal is 20 degree centigrade, means here change in temperature is 20 degree centigrade. So here delta T will be equal to 20. Now here we have to find out value of C. So we have to make C our subject. By making C our subject, we will get 5.2 into 1000 divided by 2 divided by 20. And by solving this one, we will get answer C is equal to 130 joule per kilogram degree centigrade. Now 130 joule per kilogram degree centigrade is given in option C. So correct option will be option C. Question number 18. What makes a clinical thermometer suitable for measuring small changes in body temperature? Option A, the amount of mercury in the bulb is small. Option B, the bore of the capillary tube is narrow. Option C, the capillary tube is long. Option D, the glass bulb has a thin wall. Here we have to make a clinical thermometer that is suitable for measuring small changes. Small changes means we have to make a clinical thermometer that is more sensitive. And sensitivity of a thermometer depends on the bore area of the capillary tube. Narrower the tube, more will be the sensitivity. So if we have to make a sensitive thermometer, we have to keep the bore area of the capillary tube narrow. And the bore of the capillary tube is narrow is given in option B. So our correct option will be option B. Question number 19. Substances can change from one state to another as shown. For substances to change from one state to another, there must be some energy transfer. Which changes involve the substance taking in energy and which changes involve in the substance giving out energy? Here solid is converting to liquid, means here we are melting. During melting, we require energy, we have to provide energy. So here energy is absorbed. Again, in boiling means to conversion from liquid to gases, we have to provide energy. So again, here energy is absorbed. So energy is absorbed in melting and in boiling. In 3, it is given condensation. Condensation means conversion of a gas in a liquid. When a gas is converted to liquid, energy is released. So in 3, energy is released. Again, here from liquid to solid conversion means during freezing, energy will also be released. So energy will be taken in, energy will be absorbed in 1 and 2, and energy given out will be in 3 and 4. Now we check the options. Here we have two columns, first column for energy taken in and second column for energy given out. Now energy taken in option A, it is given 1 and 2. In 1 and 2, energy is taken in. So it is our possible option. Energy given out, energy is given out in 3 and 4. Here it is given, energy is given out in 3 and 4. So our correct option will be option A. So correct option will be option A. Question number 20. How do the speed and the wavelength of red light in air compare with the speed and the wavelength of violet light in air? Both violet and red light are electromagnetic radiation, and for electromagnetic radiation the speed remains same. So speed of red and speed of violet light will be same. Now second thing, wavelength of red light will be more as compared to violet light, because wavelength increases when we move from violet towards the red. Least wavelength is for violet and maximum wavelength is for red light. So correct option will be option C. Speed of red light will be same as of violet light, and wavelength of red light will be greater as compared to wavelength of violet light. So correct option is option C. Question 21. A ray of light enters a glass block at an angle of incidence I, producing an angle of refraction R in the glass. Several different values of I and R are measured and a graph is drawn of sine I against sine R. Which graph is correct? It is incident ray, it is refracted ray. It is normal. The angle in between the incident ray and normal is called angle of incidence, and the angle in between the normal and refracted ray is called angle of refraction. Now with the increase in angle of incidence, angle of refraction further increases. Since here with the increase in angle of incidence, angle R is also increasing. So here we can say angle R is directly proportional to angle of incidence. Now if we calculate sine I and sine R, so here we can say sine R is directly proportional to sine I. And when two physical quantities are directly proportional to each other, their graph will be in a straight line. So if we plot a graph in between sine R and sine I, this graph should be in a straight line. Now we check the options. In option A and option D, we are looking that with the increase in sine R, sine I is increasing. So here in option A and option D, we can say that sine R is directly proportional to sine I. In B and C, we are looking that with the increase in sine I, sine R is decreasing. So B and C are not the possible option. Our possible options are A and D. Now here we are looking angle of incidence is more as compared to angle of refraction. Since angle of incidence is more, so definitely value of sine I will be more and value of sine R will be less. Since value of sine I is more and value of sine R is less, so the graph will be more inclined towards sine I and it will be less inclined towards sine R. Now if we check option A and option D, in option A we are looking that this graph is more inclined towards sine I. Here in D we are looking it is more inclined towards sine R. It should be more inclined towards sine I because of the fact that angle of incidence is more, it is greater than angle of refraction. So our correct option will be option A, because here this graph is in a straight line that represents that sine R is directly proportional to sine I, and it is more inclined towards sine I. So correct option will be option A. क्वेश्चन नंबर 22, अ बॉय स्टैंड बिसाइड अ गर्ल इन फ्रंट ऑफ अ लार्ज प्लेन मिरर, दे आर बोथ द सेम डिस्टेंस फ्रॉम द मिरर एज शोन, वेयर डज द बॉय सी द गर्ल्स इमेज. हियर वी हैव अ गर्ल एंड ही इज अ बॉय, बॉय इज लुकिंग द गर्ल इन दिस मिरर एंड वी हैव टू फाइंड आउट वेयर द इमेज ऑफ द गर्ल विल बी फॉर्म. इन फ्रंट ऑफ अ प्लेन मिरर the image is formed on the back side of the mirror and the distance in between the object to the mirror is equal to the distance in between the mirror and the image. So the image will be formed at point A because the distance from A to the mirror is equal to the distance from the mirror to the girl and this image is on the back side of the mirror. So the image will be formed at point A. So correct option will be option A. Question number 23. A student uses a spring to demonstrate waves. He moves the spring with his hand. Which diagram demonstrates the type of wave produced by a source of sound? When the student will move the spring, there will be a longitudinal wave. And in this longitudinal wave, we will have compression and rarefaction. Now if we check the options, in all the four options we are looking that only in the option B we have compression, then we have rarefaction, then again compression, then rarefaction. So our correct option will be option B. So correct option will be option B. Question number 24. The diagram shows the main sections of the electromagnetic spectrum in order of increasing frequency. Some of the sections are labeled. The section R has frequency just below that of light. Which application uses the section R? It is light. It is our visible spectrum. In light, in visible spectrum, we have seven colors that are violet, indigo, blue, green, yellow, orange, and red. Now red has least frequency and violet has maximum frequency. So in this visible spectrum, in this light, the order will be here we have red and here we have violet. Because here frequency is increasing on the right hand side, so violet will be on the right hand side and red will be on the left hand side. Now after violet, we have ultraviolet and before red, we have infrared. So here R represents infrared. Now we check the options. Option A, killing cancerous cell. For killing cancerous cell, we do not use infrared rays, we use X-rays. So option A is incorrect. Option B, satellite television. In satellite television, we use microwaves. Option C, sterilization. In sterilization, we use gamma radiation. Option D, television remote controller. In television remote controller, we use infrared. And infrared is the electromagnetic spectrum represented by the section R. Section R is infrared and this infrared is used in television remote controller. That is given in option D. So correct option will be option D. Question number 25. The diagram shows an alarm system. What happens when battery P is disconnected? It is battery P. When battery P is disconnected, this iron core will fall down on this iron armature. When this iron core will fall down on this iron armature, this pointer will touch this base and this circuit will be completed. And when this circuit will be completed, this bell will start to ring. Now we check the options. Here we have two columns. In the first column, iron armature. In the second column, bell is given. For iron armature, in option A and B, it is given false. In C and D, it is given moves up. Here we have noticed that when this battery is disconnected, this iron core will fall down on this iron armature and this iron armature will fall down and it will touch this base. So iron armature falls. It will fall down. False is given in A and B, so possible option will be A and B. When this iron armature falls on this base, this circuit is completed and when the circuit is completed, the bell starts to ring. And In option A, for bell it is given rings. In B, it is given stop ringing. It will start to ring. So our correct option will be option A. The iron armature falls and the bell rings. So correct option will be option A. Question number 26. Waveforms are shown on a cathode ray oscilloscope for a flute and for a guitar, each playing the same note. The oscilloscope settings are the same for both waveforms. What is the difference between the two sounds? Option A, the amplitude, B, the frequency, C, the quality, D, the wavelength. These are the two sounds, one from flute and second one from guitar. Okay, this picture is not clear. Okay, check this one. It is the waveform in flute and it is the waveform in guitar. Now first we check amplitude. What is amplitude? Amplitude is the vertical distance from mean position to peak position. So in flute, it is our amplitude. In guitar, it is our mean position, it is peak position. So this distance, this vertical distance will be the amplitude in the case of guitar. Now if we check this vertical distance and this vertical distance, both distance are same. So here we can say amplitude in flute is equal to amplitude in guitar. So this option is incorrect because we have to find out the difference and amplitude in both the cases are same. Now first we check option D, wavelength. What is wavelength? Wavelength is a distance in between two consecutive crests or in between two consecutive troughs. It is first crest, it is second crest, so the distance in between these two crests will be wavelength in flute. Now if we check the distance in between this crest and this crest, this distance and this distance are same. So wavelength in both the cases are also same because the distance in between two consecutive crests in flute and in guitar is same. So wavelength in both the cases are also same. So option D are. So option D is also incorrect. Now we check frequency. Frequency is reciprocal of wavelength. Since wavelength is same in both the cases, so definitely frequency will also be same. So option B is also incorrect. So the only possible option is option C, the quality. And what is quality? Quality is property of sound wave because of which we can make a difference in sound of same frequency and same amplitude. So our correct option will be option C, the quality. So what is our correct option? Correct option, option C, quality. Question number 27. Two metal spheres X and Y are on insulating bases. Both spheres are negatively charged. Sphere S is moved toward Y until they almost touch. Which diagram shows the final pattern of charges? Both are negatively charged. So when we will move this X close to Y, these negative charges will be repelled. So in Y, all the negative charges will be concentrated on this side, and in X, all the negative charges will be concentrated on this side. Now we check the option. The same thing is shown in option C. All the negative charges in X is shown on this side, and on Y, all the negative charges are shown on this side, because negative charges will be repelled by each other. So correct option will be option C. Question number 28. The resistance of a cylindrical wire P is 80 ohm. A second wire Q is made from the same material. The cross-sectional area of Q is 4 times that of P. The length of Q is twice that of P. What is the resistance of Q? Here we have two wires. It is wire P, it is wire Q. We have to find out the resistance of wire Q. For wire P, the resistance is given 80 ohm, and it is given here that both the wires are made of same material. Now we check how we can calculate this one. Resistance is given as rho L over A, where this rho for resistivity, L for length, and A for area. Now let us suppose that cross-sectional area of P is A. If cross section area of P is A, then cross section area of Q will be 4A, because here it is given that cross section area of Q is 4 times of P. So if we have taken cross section area of P A, then cross section area of Q will be 4A. Now second thing, we have assumed that length of wire P is L. Length of the wire P is L. And here the condition is given, length of Q is twice length of P. So length of Q will be equal to 2L. Now here cross section area of Q is 4A and length of Q is 2L. Resistance in Q we have to find out. So to calculate resistance in Q, we will use the formula rho L over A. Now value of rho we don't know, so we will keep rho as it is. Now here length of Q is equal to 2L, so in place of L we will write 2L. Area of Q is equal to 4 times of A, so here in place of area we can write 4A. Now the equation will become resistance in Q is equal to rho into 2L divided by 4A. Now by rearranging we will get 2 over 4 rho L over A. Now this rho L over A is equal to 80 ohms. Here it is given resistance in P is 80 ohm. So value of this rho L over A, or we can say resistance in P is equal to 80 ohm. Now in place of this rho L over A, we can substitute 80, and by solving this one, we will get the answer 40 ohms. 40 ohms is given in option B. So our correct option will be option B, resistance of Q is 40 ohm. Question number 29. A lamp designed to work at 1.5 volt is connected to a cell of electromotive force 1.5 volt. The lamp lights at normal brightness. The lamp is now connected to four similar cells, each of EMF 1.5 volt. Arrange in parallel. What is the effect of connecting the extra cell in this way? Here we have only one cell and the electromotive force or voltage is 1.5 volt. Now here we have connected four cells in parallel with the same lamp. When we will connect two or more cells in parallel, total energy supplied is increased. And when total energy supplied will be increased, the lamp will light for longer time. So we check the option now. In option A, it is given the lamp burst out. Option B, the lamp is dimmer. Option C, the lamp produces light for a longer time. It is our correct option. Or in option D, it is given the lamp produces light for the shorter time. No, it will produce the light for the longer time that is given in option C. So correct option will be option C. Question number 30. The current in a filament lamp is 0.25 ampere when working normally. The lamp is connected to a plug and the mains AC supply. When the lamp is switched on, it does not light. What is the possible cause for this? Here it is given the lamp was working normally. When it is connected to a plug, now it is not working and we have to find out the cause or we have to find out the reason. There may be only one cause, that the circuit is not completed. And if the circuit is not completed, either the live wire is broken or the return wire, or we can say the normal wire is broken. Now we check the option. Option A, the earth wire in the plug is not connected. Option B, the fuse in the plug is 3 ampere. Option C, the lamp only works on a DC power supply. Option D, the live wire in the plug is not connected. Yes, option D is the correct option. The live wire in the plug is not connected. That's why the circuit is not completed. And when the circuit is not completed, it will not light. So correct option will be option D. Question 31. Which appliance used on a 240 volt supply is most likely to burn out its fuse? Fuse is used for protection of an electrical circuit. and the rating of the fuse, the amperage of the fuse should be more than the electrical current that is drawn by the appliance. Now we check the options. Here we have two columns. In the first column, appliance is given. In the second column, fuse is given. For the appliance, in option A, B, C, and D, we have electrical power. And in the second column for fuse, here the fuse rating is given. Now here what we have to do, first you have to calculate the amount of current drawn by each appliance, by the appliances that are given in option A to D. Now to find out electrical current in all the appliances, what we have to do, we have to use the formula E is equal to VI. From this equation, we will get current. Current will be equal to P over V. Now here in option A, power is given 100 watt and voltage is given here 240 volt. So current will be equal to 42 ampere. Now current drawn by the appliance in option A is 0.42 ampere, and here fuse rating is 1 ampere, that is more than 0.42. So here fuse will not burn. Now we check option B. In option B we have power 1 kilowatt. 1 kilowatt means 1000 watt. So we will divide 1000 by 240 to find out the amount of current. When we will divide 1000 by 240, we will get 4.2 ampere. And in option B, the fuse rating is 5 ampere, that is more than 4.2 ampere. So here fuse will not burn. Now in option C, here we have 2 kilowatt fan. Means here power is 2000 watt. Here voltage is 240. When we will divide 2000 by 240, we have a current and its value is 8.3 ampere. And here fuse rating, we are using 3 ampere. The current drawn by the appliance is more than the current of the fuse. Here fuse is of 3 ampere and the current drawn is 8.3 ampere. So here if we will use a fuse of 3 ampere, this fuse will burn out. So our correct option will be option C. In D, we have 3 kilowatt electric fire. 3 kilowatt means 3000 watt. 3000 watt will be divided by 240. And here we will get current 12.5 ampere. And in option D, we are using a fuse of 13 ampere, that is more than 12.5 ampere. So here also fuse will not burn out. Fuse will burn out only in the option C, because in option C, current drawn is more than the fuse rating. So here the fuse will burn out. So correct option will be option C. Question number 32. The diagram shows a potential divider system of two resistors connected to a 6 volt power supply. What is the reading on the voltmeter? Here in the system, total voltage is 6 volt. And in this system, we have connected two resistors, one of 2000 ohm and second is 10,000 ohm. And we have to find out potential difference across the resistor 10,000 ohm. Now to find out the potential difference across the resistor 10,000 ohm, we will take help of voltage divider rule. In voltage divider rule, we have to divide this voltage V, this potential difference V, by total voltage, total potential difference of the system. Means we have to divide this V by 6. And this ratio will be equal to resistor connected across this voltmeter divided by total resistance. Now resistance connected across this voltmeter, across this voltage is 10,000 ohm. And total resistance will be equal to 10,000 plus 2,000, it will be 12,000. So what will be the equation? Equation will be V divided by 6 is equal to 10,000 divided by 12,000. V divided by 6 is equal to 10,000 divided by 12,000. And by solving this one, we will get the potential difference and it will be equal to 5 volt. Now 5 volt is given in option D. So correct option will be option D. Question number 33. In the circuit shown, the alarm bell will only start ringing sometime after the switch is closed. What caused the time delay? Option A, the capacitor charging. Option B, the capacitor discharging. Option C, the resistor cooling down. Option D, resistor heating up. In C and D, resistor is given. And purpose of resistor is just to increase or decrease the hindrance in the flow of electrical current. So resistor is not related to टाइम डिले. सो सी एंड डी आर नॉट द पॉसिबल ऑप्शन, द ओनली पॉसिबल ऑप्शन आर ए एंड बी. नाउ हियर इट इज गिवन व्हेन वी क्लोज द सर्किट आफ्टर सम टाइम द बेल स्टार्ट रिंगिंग. मीन्स हियर दिस कैपेसिटर इज चार्जिंग एंड व्हेन द कैपेसिटर इज चार्ज आफ्टर दैट द बेल विल स्टार्ट टू रिंग. If it is discharging, then what will happen if the bell is ringing? After some time, it will stop. And here it is given, after some time, the bell starts ringing. Means here the capacitor is charging. And when the capacitor is charged, the bell starts to ring. Now the capacitor charging is given in option A. So correct option will be option A. Question number 34. Two parallel wires carry current in the same direction. Which diagram shows the magnetic field around each wire and the direction of the force on each wire? If we have two parallel wires and in these two parallel wires electrical current is passing in same direction, then the magnetic field produced because of the flow of electrical current in both the wires will be in same direction. In option A we are looking. We have electrical current and these electrical currents are in same direction. In both the wire, the electrical current is in downward direction. So the magnetic field produced because of the electrical current in both the wire will be in same direction. Here we are looking the direction of the magnetic field is clockwise. Here also we are looking the direction of magnetic field is clockwise. So in both the cases, direction of magnetic field is same. And when there is an electrical current in same direction in two wires, there will be a force of attraction in between the wires. Now in option A we are looking the direction of electrical current in both the wires are in same direction. The direction of magnetic fields around both the wires are also in same direction. And here it shows force of attraction in between two wires. So our correct option will be option A. In option B, it is shown that magnetic field in one wire, it is in clockwise direction and in second wire, it is anti-clockwise direction. That's why it is incorrect because in both the wires, the direction of magnetic field will be in one direction, in same direction. So option B is incorrect. In option C, we are looking direction of the magnetic field is in same direction. In both the cases, magnetic field is clockwise. But here it is shown there is a force of repulsion in between these two wires. There will not be force of repulsion, there will be force of attraction. So this option is incorrect because of the reason that here force is shown, force of repulsion. These two wires are moving away from each other, means there is force of repulsion. So option C is also incorrect. In option D we are looking that direction of magnetic field is opposite to each other. In this case, direction of magnetic field is clockwise. Here it is anti-clockwise. Second thing, here also the forces are shown, force of repulsion, because here it is shown that both the wires are moving away from each other. So option D is also incorrect. Correct option is option A. When electrical current is passed in two wires in same direction, direction of magnetic field will be same. And there will be force of attraction in between these two wires. So correct option is option A. Question number 35. The diagram shows three electrical devices X, Y and Z. Which devices provide an alternating current AC output? In X, an alternating generator is shown, so it will provide alternating current. In Y, a DC motor is shown. DC motor cannot provide alternating current, so Y will not provide alternating current. In Z, a dynamo is shown. It is also an alternating generator, so it will also provide alternating current. So alternating current will be provided in X and in Z. X and Z is given in option D, so correct option will be option D. Question number 36. One component of a simple DC motor is a stirring commutator. Which metal is used to make the commutator and why this metal chosen? Here we have two columns. In the first column, metal is given. In the second column, reason is given. In column A and B, copper, and in C and D, iron is given. purpose of split ring commutator in a simple DC motor is to pass electrical current. And to pass electrical current, the metal that we have to use should be a good conductor of electricity. Now, if we check copper and iron, copper is better electrical conductor as compared to iron. So we have to use here copper. Now, copper is given in A and B. So our possible option will be A and B. Why we have used copper here? Because of the fact that copper is good conductor of electricity. And this reason is given in option A. It is good conductor of electricity. So our correct option will be option A. The metal we have to use copper, and the reason it is good conductor of electricity. Question number 37. A small coil is connected to a galvanometer G as shown. When a magnet is allowed to fall towards the coil, the galvanometer pointer gives a momentary deflection to the right of the zero position. The magnet moves through the coil. What happens to the galvanometer pointer as the magnet falls away from the coil? This magnet is moving towards the coil. When the magnet is moving towards the coil, the deflection in the galvanometer needle is on the right hand side and it is momentary. Now, if we will reverse the direction of the magnet, what will happen? The deflection of the galvanometer pointer will be on the other side. It will be on the left hand side. And second thing, it will be momentary deflection. So if we will reverse the direction of the magnet, the direction of the galvanometer pointer will be on left hand side and it will be momentary. Now we check the options. Option A, it gives a continuous reading to the left. No, it will give the reading on the left hand side, but it will not be continuous. It will be momentary. So option A is incorrect. Option B, it gives a momentary deflection to the left. Yes, it is correct. When we will reverse the direction of the magnet, the direction of the galvanometer pointer will also be reversed. Before it was on the right hand side, now it will be on the left hand side, and this deflection will be momentary. So here correct option will be option B. Question number 38. One isotope of carbon is C614. How many neutrons and protons does each atom of this isotope contain? This 6 represents proton number. Proton number means number of proton. And this 14 represents nucleon number. Nucleon number means sum of proton and neutron. Now here we have two columns. In the first column, number of neutron. In the second column, number of proton is given. Here proton number is 6. So definitely number of protons in this carbon will be 6. Now 6 is given in A, C and D, so possible option will be A, C and D. Now here this 40, it is nucleon number. Nucleon number means sum of proton and neutron. And if we have to find out number of neutron, what we have to do? We have to subtract proton number from this nucleon number. Means we have to subtract 6 from 14. When we will subtract 6 from 14, we will get 8. So in this isotope of carbon, number of protons are 6 and number of neutrons are 8. Number of protons are 6, number of neutrons are 8. It is given in option C. So correct option will be option C. Question number 39. The isotope barium-140 has a half-life of 13 days. A sample of this isotope is kept for 13 days. Which quantity halves during this time? Half-life means time taken by a radioactive substance to be half of its number of atoms. So after 13 days, in the isotope of barium-140, the number of barium atoms will be half of its initial number of atoms. Now we check the options. Option A, the number of atoms of barium-140 in the sample. Yes, it is correct. After 13 days, number of barium atom will be half of its initial number. So correct option will be option A. Question number 40. In a laboratory experiment, particles from a radioactive source are deviated by a magnetic field and reach a detector. Which particles are deviated and reach the detector? Here we have a radioactive source. It is detector, and here we have magnetic field. This magnetic field is into the paper, and the radiation that is emitted out from this radioactive source is deflected in this magnetic field. Since the ray that is emitted out from radioactive source is deflected in the magnetic field, means this ray should be a charged particle. Either it will be positive charge or it will be negative charge. Now positive charge is on alpha particle and negative charge is on beta particle. So the radiation or the rays that are emitted out from this radioactive source are either alpha particle or it is beta particle. It cannot be gamma particle because gamma particles are not deflected in magnetic field. And here we have a deflection, so definitely we will have a charged particle, and this charged particle may be either alpha particle or it may be beta particle. Now we have to find out whether it is alpha or it is beta. To find out whether it is alpha or it is beta, we have to take help of Fleming's left hand rule. What is a Fleming left hand rule? In Fleming left hand rule, this finger, first finger, it represents direction of magnetic field. This second finger, it represents direction of flow of electrical current or movement of electrical charges. And the direction of thumb represents the resultant force. And one thing more, the direction of this second finger, it represents direction of flow of positive charges. So this one is direction of magnetic field. This direction is a flow of positive charges. And this thumb represents direction of net resultant force. Now here, if we will use Fleming left hand rule, direction of the magnetic field will be into the paper, means it is in the downward direction. Direction of the second finger will point us, means it is coming towards us. And the direction of the thumb will be on the right hand side, means if we have a positive charge, if we have a positive particle, then the direction of the force will be on the right hand side. But here we are looking that it is deflected on the left hand side. Deflection on the left hand side means here the force is on the left hand side, not in the right hand side. If it is in the right hand side, then it will be positive charge particle. And if it is in the left hand side, then it will be negatively charged particle. Now negatively charged particle is beta particle, and beta particle is given in option D. So correct option will be option D. So what will be the correct option? Correct option, option D. Now we have completed all the questions from the paper 5054, paper 1, variant 1 of October, number 11. Thank you very much.